Good morning, everyone. Good to see all of you here this morning. Obviously, as you look around in the crowd, we're down a little bit this morning, and that's because we have a number of our people up at Ivydale, at the church camp up there, as we began our teen camps, and so some of our people are gone because of that. But nevertheless, your singing was absolutely fabulous this morning. Thank you so much for singing out so well. If you're visiting with us, we want you to know that we're glad that you're here as well. For those of you who are streaming, good seeing you with us. So we're just all together and things are going great. Before I begin my message, let me just share with you some things that are important. Number one, if you haven't already done so as a member, please check in. That would certainly help the elders in keeping track of our membership. And then if you're visiting, if you would also please text in the word guest so that we have a record of your attendance. That way we can send a note out to you thanking you for attending and being with us this morning. Also, let me remind you as a congregation about our Vacation Bible School. That's just around the corner. I mean, it's going to be here before you know it. And so maybe you might be thinking about getting your children ready for Vacation Bible School. And not only that, but inviting maybe your neighborhood kids to partake of that. It's going to be a great time together with one another. And then our young families and young adults are having a seminar. The World We Live In with Joe Wells is going to be here and sharing with us, and that's going to be a good time as well. So certainly be putting those dates aside as being important for us. You know, since the beginning of our nation, we have had various presidential inaugurations. In fact, we've had over 59 of them. Every four-year term begins with an inauguration as we think about the next president. And then there are about 13 of our presidents who have had multiple inaugurations for their terms as they have served our country. In fact, of course, Joe Biden was inaugurated the president of the United States as the 46th president. And generally, when you talk about inaugurations, they are filled with some pomp and some circumstance. Usually, a lot of excitement gathers around that event. Sometimes they're more exciting than in others. Obviously, this last inauguration on the 20th of January wasn't probably as filled with as many people in the plaza as is normal because of the pandemic. But nevertheless, there were those who were extremely excited about him becoming our president. Some of the presidential inaugurations of late have not been quite the fanfare that they have been in the past, and that could be possibly because of the polarization of the political scene that is going on, and a lot of those kinds of things have somewhat dampened the fervor and the excitement. And yet when you're talking about an inauguration, it really is exciting because it's talking about our democracy. And that even though we might have polar sides when it comes down to politics, nevertheless, we are a democracy. We are a country that is together as a unit, and that's why we're called the United States. And so we are able to celebrate that fact that, you know, we're able to make these transitions without much of a fanfare in terms of violence or anything like that. But anyway, we have these inauguration kinds of things. So exactly what is an inauguration? Well, it's the formal admission of someone to an office, such as a president or a governor. If you were talking about kings, you might say it's a coronation of one into a high office or into a high position as a king, or a ceremony marking the beginning of something. Well, when you talk about inauguration, certainly they have a lot of things that go into them. And in keeping with our theme that I've been sharing with you, at least for the 2 weeks prior to this week, we've been talking about the king and his kingdom. And you might recall in the very first lesson, we talked about an unlikely king. And I said he was an unlikely king because he came into the world in a very different way than you would think a king would come into the world. Generally, when a king comes into the world or becomes a king, there is a lot of celebration that goes on, a lot of parties, a lot of things that surround that. And yet when Jesus, the king of the universe, the creator of the universe, when he came into our world, you don't find that kind of thing happening at all. In fact, this king came into our world to be the savior of the world in a very different and unlikely place. I mean, who possibly could have imagined or even thought of a king coming in this world in the back alley stall where you placed animals and be wrapped up in swaddling and then laid in a manger? We just don't think of kings coming in that fashion, and yet that's how this king came into our world, the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And when a king comes in, obviously he causes some disruption. there's a lot of disruption happened when Jesus came, especially when Herod the Great found out that there was a king of the Jews that was there that coming rivaled him and his power, because Herod was one of these guys who was, he was power hungry. He was a super narcissist. I mean, he was a tyrant in his own right. And so when he found out that there was one called King of the Jews by the Magi, probably 2 years after the birth, that alarmed him so much so that he reacted in a violent kind of way by having so many children slaughtered from the age of 2 years old and down. When a king comes into the world, things become to change. And Jesus, this unlikely king, when he made his advent, he changed our world forever. And then last week, I talked to you about the announcement of a king. And we began talking about John the Baptist, who came a wild-looking man. He was a man with uncut hair. He was a man who wore camel-haired clothing with a leather belt around his midsection. And it says that he ate, you know, locusts and wild honey. And he had a message, and a message that was so strong and so powerful, with one with such authority, that it says that people were coming from around Jerusalem, Judea, from the environs of the Jordan, and they were coming to John and they were listening to his message. And his message was one of repentance. Repent, he said, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. God had been silent for over 400 years. And now God is speaking, and there's something unique, something peculiar, something different about John's message that was different from the leaders in the Sadducees or the Pharisees or any of the Jewish hierarchy that made him stand out. So people were coming to him, and they were responding to his message. And it says they were coming and being baptized. There is a change going on there. So the announcement of a king, and Jesus then comes upon the scene, and he'll have the same exact message: to repent, for the kingdom of God or the kingdom of heaven is at hand. This morning, I want to talk to you about a third element of Jesus being king, and that is the inauguration of the king. When you talk about an inauguration, remember it says it's a ceremony marked by the beginning of something incredible. This is going to be the beginning of his kingdom becoming a reality, and one that becomes a reality for you and as well as for me as well. The inauguration of Jesus marked the beginning of his formal ministry on earth. Charles mentioned that this morning. That ministry would last for about 3 years and would culminate in his death on the cross and then his resurrection and then his ascension into heaven. The inauguration is going to be marked by two events. The first one will be his baptism that was read to us a few moments ago by Brandon. And in that inauguration and in that baptism, when he comes up out of the water, says the Spirit began to descend upon him in the form of a dove, and a voice from heaven said, "This is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased." And then the second one is he is going to be tested. His kingship is going to be challenged in the wilderness by the devil. And that seems to be the natural process of many who are followers of God when you think about it. For instance, one day you have feel this deep sense that you are loved by God and that there is this affirmation of God for you. You feel a closeness for God, and then all of a sudden, the next day, you find yourself second-guessing how much God may love you or even his affirmation. That sometimes happens because of maybe the circumstances that comes flooding into our lives. It could be because of a temptation that has come our way. It might be because of some sin that we have done in our lives, and it causes us to make a distance between us and God, and we begin to wonder to ourselves, does God love me? Does God still affirm me? It's a terrible road to be on. It's kind of like, you know, God loves me, he loves me not, he loves me, and he loves me not, and we forget all about how much God is gracious and how much he loves us, all the way to the point that he would send his Son into the world, the King of kings and the Lord of lords, to die on the cross for us. But in those moments when we find ourselves feeling as though maybe God does not love us, or feeling that there's this emptiness or this void inside us, we began to think to ourselves, maybe we need to take matters into our own hands. Maybe there is a desire that I want more than anything in the world that I don't feel as though the kingdom is fulfilling that, so that's the desire I'm going to go after. Or maybe it's a trust problem, or maybe there is a power problem with us. We want to be in control of things, and so we decide to work things out for ourselves. Life is like that in some ways. Jesus is going to be baptized by John in the Jordan. He's going to hear those incredible words of his Father, but before he almost gets those things even out of his mouth, it says that the Spirit is going to lead him into the wilderness where he is going to be tested, and it's going to go on for about 40 days. Well, when Jesus comes into our world, he comes in a different kind of fashion as a king. He comes as a humble king. And that's unlike any kings that we think about in history. When you think about kings, you don't think about their humility. When you think about kings today, you would think, or in times past, we think about a king with power. We think about a king that is bathed in opulence. We think about a king whose feet are washed by servants. We think about a king whose subjects sacrifice for them in order that he might maintain that kingly position. But not so with Jesus. Jesus is seen as a humble king. Look again at Matthew, the third chapter, verses 13 through 15. Matthew chapter 3, verses 13 through 15. There it says, "Then Jesus arrived from Galilee at the Jordan, coming to John to be baptized by him. But John tried to prevent him, saying, 'I have need to be baptized by you, and do you come to me?'" Remember in other sections of Scripture, John, when he speaks about Jesus and the Jewish leaders are talking to him about Jesus, Jesus says, "Listen, I'm not the one. In fact, I'm not even worthy to unlatch the sandals on his feet. There is one who is greater than I. I must decrease, but he must increase." And here John is, has been asked by Jesus to baptize him. And John, he's got a problem with that. "I need to be baptized by you, and yet you come to me." But Jesus answering said to him, Permit it at this time, for this is the way is fitting for us to fulfill all righteousness." And then he permitted him. So Jesus requests John to baptize him. And Jesus, you know, he responds to him that, "Listen, you need to do this because we need to fulfill all righteousness." And there is a humility that is there. One who is lesser than himself is now baptizing the one who is the king. And that's an incredible thought when you talk about that kind of humility that's on display. Jesus says, "Let's permit it at this time so we might fulfill all righteousness." There is a humble example that he's given by those who are in his presence and in that present day, but it's one that even filters down to us almost 2,000 years later, that there is a humility in this king. And it's something that is undeniable when you talk about great leadership. Jesus is the humble king. He is the one who's willing to sacrifice off and give up all. But it's not the first time we talk about the humility. Paul, later in his writings, will go all the way back into eternity and talk about the humility of Jesus Christ in Philippians, the second chapter, verses 6 through 8. Beginning in verse 6, "Who, although he existed in the form of God, did not regard equality with God a thing to be grasped." Some translation says, "counted it not robbery." Another one says that he would not take advantage of. "Who, although he existed in the form of God, did not regard equality with God a thing to be grasped, but he emptied himself, taking the form of a bondservant, being made in the likeness of man, being found in the appearance as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death upon the cross." There's great humility that is seen in that very idea. Jesus humbled himself when he took on the very nature of a servant, as a human being. I mean, think about him being a servant. In one passage, Jesus said, "I did not come to be served, but to serve, and to give my life a ransom for many." Kings don't serve. Kings are those who are served. If you were to think about John the 13th chapter, on the eve of his arrest, as well as then his crucifixion the next day, there it says that Jesus gathers together with those who were closest to him, the 12 apostles, And there it says, as they all walked into the room, not a one stopped to wash the other's feet. And yet Jesus gets up from supper, knowing that they all had dirty feet, and he goes around, it says, and he girds himself about with a towel and takes water and begins to wash those disciples' feet. Even one that he knows is going to betray him, he washes their feet. This is the King of the universe, the creator of the world, and yet he can humble himself and take on this task of a servant. So tell me, what king do you know would do this? What man of power or possession could you imagine doing this? And it doesn't stop there, because as you go on down through Philippians, it says he becomes obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. So he humbles himself. He has the power to call 10 legions of angels to rescue him, and yet he doesn't do it. He humbles himself to a government. He humbles himself to soldiers. He allows himself to be beaten, to be spit upon, to be mocked, to have nails hammered into his hands and into his feet. And he hangs suspended between heaven and earth. God in the flesh humbles himself to the point of death. What king do you know would do that? We say, well, you know, listen, there are kings who would sacrifice for their people. They would sacrifice for the good of the nation, for good people. But would they sacrifice themselves for bad people? Would they sacrifice themselves for wicked people or evil people or people who were of such great offense? Would they sacrifice for that? And my answer to that is, I don't think so. In fact, I almost know they would not. But Jesus did. Jesus is the humble king who became a servant and who sacrificed himself for the good of the people, which tells me that humility is a key component when it comes down to kingdom life. And because of his humility, God recognizes that. If Jesus was a humble king, and if the kingdom is to be his, then that means that within the kingdom we are to be a humble people. And that we may have power, we may have influence, but uniquely we are to be people of humility, where we humble ourselves to be servants as he was, to sacrifice as he sacrificed, to love as he loved. Because of his humility, God raises him up and seats him at his right hand. Hebrews, the 12th chapter in verse 2, tells us to fix our eyes on Jesus, who is the author and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy set before him despised the cross and its shame, and then sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. That is incredible good news. In fact, Charles mentioned it as he shared with us some thoughts about the Lord's Supper, as he talked about Romans, the 8th chapter, and verse 34, because it says he is seated at the right hand of God, where he intercedes for us, where he intercedes on our behalf. He is a king, while at the same time being our advocate. I love what the Apostle John wrote in 1 John, the 2nd chapter, verses 1 and 2. There he says, "My little children, do not sin. But if you do, you have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous one, and he is the propitiation, not for my sins, but for the sins of the world." He becomes that atoning sacrifice. He becomes that advocate. That word advocate means one called alongside. Think about it in terms of a law scene or a scene of judgment, where you're standing before a judge, and we find ourselves before God, and we stand before him after some sin in our lives, and it says that Jesus comes alongside. He is our advocate, and he advocates on our behalf. The difference is he didn't say, Father, Nolan here, he is a good man, and he is a faithful husband, a great grandfather. He's been a great servant of yours. He doesn't advocate on behalf of how good we are. In fact, he'll even tell the Father, yes, this guy, Nolan, this man, Richard, is a sinner, but I purchased him. I sacrificed for him. My blood bled for him, and my blood has cleansed him. He advocates on our behalf. He becomes that sacrifice for us. And then he's also given all dominion over all of creation, all rule, all a power, all authority, all dominion. And why wouldn't he, since he is the creator of all of it in the first place? So Jesus is given those things. And if you go on down through Philippians, the second chapter there, beyond verse 8, going down to verse 11, there you'll find that Jesus is given a name also. And that name that he is given is one that all will confess, and that is the name Lord. He is placed in a high place. He is King of kings, Lord of lords. He is our intercessor, our advocate. He's on our side in this life, and that is incredible. And so when we talk about kingdom living, then it has to do with humility. So where have humility and obedience led you in your life? Would you consider yourself to be a humble person? Where has pride caused you to fall? Where you think there's this image that you're supposed to have and people expect you to have. You have this image that you don't want to lower yourself in. What pride is there that has kept you from being the way God would have you to be? And if you had to walk away from everything to become a servant in order to one day gain a kingdom, could you do that? Jesus says, if anyone wishes to follow after me, let him deny himself. Take up his cross and follow me. Well, you can talk about denying yourself. And then Jesus says, even to the point of death, even to carrying or bearing a cross, certainly is a challenge. And if you said, yeah, I would do that, would you really, if it got, you know, if it really got down to it? So the question that came to my mind as we talk about a humble king is this, is why did Jesus humble himself as a king? And there can only be one answer. And that is, this is how we know what love is. Jesus Christ laid down his life for us. In other words, Jesus humbled himself because of his love for us, because of his love for you. If you go back to Matthew, the third chapter, once again, okay, notice verses 16 and 17. It said, after being baptized, Jesus came up immediately from the water. And behold, the heavens were opened, and he saw the Spirit of God descending upon him as a dove and lighting on him. And behold, a voice out of heaven said, this is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. So at Jesus' baptism, I said that it's the beginning of his ministry and his position and his inauguration because of his baptism. And as he comes up out of the water, God affirms that very fact. There's this affirmation of Jesus' position and his son's priority and the object of his affection. This is my son. This is not just any man. In fact, if you go over to, I think it's John, the first chapter, and verse 18, it says that he is the only begotten of the Father, the only unique one, the only one of a kind. This is my son. He's divine, in other words. He is the king. This is my son, in whom I am well pleased. Remember that passage of scripture that says that Jesus, as he grew in wisdom, in stature, and in favor with both man and God. God is affirming at his baptism that he has an affection for this son like none other. This is my beloved son in whom I am well pleased. There is that affection that is there. And in the same way that God bursts forth with love for Jesus at his baptism, that he has this great love for him, is the same thing that happens for us when we, in obedience to our faith, are baptized into Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of our sins. Think not that heaven does not burst forth in joy and rejoicing over one sinner that repents and one sinner that is rescued from the clutches of the evil one. There is a blessing that is there. There is an affection that is there for us because of what God and what Jesus has done. And there's going to be moments in your life when you feel that you have blown it really bad and that maybe, you know, you don't deserve God's love. You don't deserve God's affection and his affirmation. Paul reminds us of something, and here he says, For I am convinced neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, nor either height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. It's an impossibility on God's side of things, but not necessarily on our side of things. We can separate ourselves, but God always remains faithful. And that's really good news to us, especially when you take into account the fact that we oftentimes do sin and fall short, to know that there is this promise that is given to us and to know that we can always come back. 1 John 1 and verse 9 says that if we confess our sins, it says that he's faithful to the Father, that he's faithful and righteous to forgive us of all of our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. That's part of the blessing of kingdom living. This dynamic, this eternal, powerful love helped get Jesus through the wilderness of temptation. The promise is that it will do the same for us. And that's what makes this kingdom vastly different from all other kingdoms. So, but what if it were different? What if love was replaced with all the power or all the money or all the resources that you could imagine? What I'm asking you is, what if you could exchange God's love for all these things that the world offers? People take that exchange all the time. People make that trade all the time, where they trade kingdom blessings for earthly things. And so Jesus is going to be put to the test as you get down to chapter 4 and verse 1. There it says, after his baptism, immediately it says that the Spirit leads him to the wilderness. I thought about showing you some pictures of the wilderness, but pictures of the wilderness, they just don't do it justice. But I'm here to tell you, I've been down to that place. And then the wilderness, and often into the great wilderness, you can't probably find a more desolate place on the face of this planet. I mean, you're talking about rugged, jagged rocks. You're talking about a land that devours itself and drinks up the life of those who try to inhabit it. It's a tough place. It says that Jesus is led into the wilderness, and that he'll be there for 40 days fasting. And then it says he's going to become hungry, and when he does so, it's going to say that the evil one or the devil comes to him to tempt him. When it says that he is hungry, that's probably the understatement of the century. Because if you've gone without food for 40 days, I'm telling you that you are driven to hunger in the most incredible kinds of ways. Look at Matthew, the 4th chapter, if you would, please. Notice what it says. Then Jesus was led up by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. And after he had fasted 40 days and 40 nights, he then became hungry. And the tempter came to him and said, if you are the Son of God, command these stones to become bread. And he answered and said, it is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but from every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. So he is tested. And the first test is the test of desire. If you were a person who is hungry and you have not eaten for 40 days, what is the one thing that's on your mind? What is the one thing that you obsess over if it's not for food? And Satan, he throws in an interesting two-letter word, if. If you are the Son of God. I find that to be interesting for several reasons. Number one, before he goes into the wilderness, he has heard the words of affirmation from his Father that says, this is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. And the first thing that Satan comes at him with, if you are the Son of God, turn these stones into bread. I am convinced that if Jesus had desired to do so, he could have turned those stones into bread. He could have done that. You say, well, how do you know that? Because at the wedding feast in Cana of Galilee, he changed water into wine. In John the 6th chapter, when he fed the 5,000 with 5 loaves and 2 fish, he feeds 5,000 people with loaves left over. He walks on water. He raises the dead from back to life. There's numerous discussions and examples and events of Jesus being able to do the unimaginable, the miraculous. He could have changed those stones into bread, but here's what he says to Satan. He says, man does not live by bread alone, but from every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. He answers him with scripture. I'm not listening to you. I know who my Father is. If you're saying, if you are the Son of God, do this. I know who I am. 40 days of fasting doesn't change that fact in Jesus' mind, even though he was weak and susceptible. There are times when we get weak and susceptible because of our desires. God promises to take care of all of our needs, but sometimes we think we need to get ahead of that. When it comes down to a roof over our head, our clothes on our back, our food in our bodies, we think that we need to take care of those things. God has promised to take care of those things. And that's why Jesus would say, seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. Don't worry about those things. God will take care of you. Jesus passed the tests of desire. Then there's the test of trust. Look at verses 5 through 7. Then the devil took him into the holy city and had him stand on the pinnacle of the temple and said to him, if you are the Son of God, throw yourself down, for it is written, he will command his angels concerning you, and on their hands they will bear you up, so that you will not strike your foot against the stone. Jesus said to him, on the other hand, it is written, you shall not put the Lord your God to the test. Again, I would say to you that Jesus could have cast himself over the temple and that the angels would bear him up. In fact, we know from the scriptures that he could have called 10 legions of angels when he is on the cross. But Jesus knew who he was and what he was, that he was the king. And so he placed his trust in God. I don't have to worry about things. God will take care of me. And he answered Satan with that you're not to tempt the Lord your God. Sometimes we are tempted to do that ourselves, aren't we? God, if you'll do this, if I do this, will you do that? We try to make a deal with him. And what Jesus is teaching us is that you don't have to make deals with God. God has promised to take care of you. And that you can trust him when it comes down to even a fall, that he will raise you up. Then we see the test of power, verses 8 through 10. Again, the devil took him to a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their glory. And he said to him, all these things I will give you if you fall down and worship me. And Jesus said to him, go, Satan, for it is written, you shall worship the Lord your God and serve him only. And Satan departs. The test of power. Here's all the kingdoms. Here's all the powers. They are all yours if you'll worship me. I find it almost laughable that Satan would tempt him. He must have thought Jesus was really weak, because we're talking about the creator of the universe. We're talking about the one who has all dominion, all power, all rule. And yet he thinks that he can bribe him with kingdoms of the earth. He created the kingdoms of the earth. He's in control of all things. There's only one thing that is important to him, is that you worship God and him alone, which challenges us. Is there anything that we would exchange? Any power, any prominence, any fame, any popularity, any position, would we exchange those things for having a relationship with God and living in this kingdom? That's the challenge that is placed there. So Jesus is inaugurated as King of Kings at his baptism. He proves that he is king because of his testing. And so he becomes an incredible example for us in how we live our lives when it comes down to the new kingdom or kingdom living. So the kingdom of heaven is filled with love and joy and peace. We're talking about the love of the Father. We're talking about the humility of the Son. We're talking about the eternal hope that is given to each and every one of us if we stay faithful all the way to the end. But at the same time, in the kingdom, there are going to be challenges. There's going to be real adversaries. Just like Jesus was challenged by Satan, there are going to be adversaries that are going to come at us as well. There's going to be a society that's going to come at us, and they're going to mock us, and they're going to ridicule us, and there's going to be some negativity come our way. There are going to be challenges that are there. Our friends are going to challenge us. Those that we work with can challenge us. Those that we work for can challenge us. Even our nation's government might challenge us when it comes down to who we're going to be faithful to. And not only will there be adversaries of that nature, sometimes we can become even our own worst enemies. Because there's going to be this internal struggle, spiritually speaking, where we wage war against the flesh and the spirit. The Apostle Paul found himself in that exact predicament over in Romans, the seventh chapter. If you'll just take a moment just to look at some of the things that are said there, beginning in verse 15. Beginning in verse 14, he says, "For we know that the law is spiritual, but I am flesh, sold into bondage to sin. For what I am doing, I do not understand, for I am not practicing what I would like to do, but I'm doing the very thing I hate. But if I do the very thing I do not want to do, I agree with the law, confessing that the law is good. So now no longer am I the one doing it, but the sin which dwells in me. For I know that nothing good dwells in me, that is, in my flesh, for the willing is present in me, but the doing of good is not. For the good that I want, I do not do, but I practice the very evil that I do not want." You see the struggle that's going on there? And my thought is that, listen, if the great Apostle Paul, when you think about great heroes of faith, Paul is certainly there. If Paul struggles inwardly, don't you think that sometimes we might struggle the same? That there is that struggle that is there? Paul's conclusion, verse 24, "Wretched man that I am, who will set me free from this body of death?" Now look at verse 25 is the answer. "Thanks be to God through Jesus Christ our Lord. So then on the one hand, I myself with my mind am serving the law of God, but on the other with my flesh, the law of sin." Verse 8, chapter 8, verse 1. "Therefore there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus." I know there's debate about Romans, the seventh chapter. Is this before he became a Christian and was trapped in the law, and then afterwards? I doubt the struggle stops because you're baptized into Christ. I think the old man is always going to try to fight for life. In fact, it's not going to give up without a fight. I know 2 Corinthians 5:17 says, "If any man is in Christ, the old has passed away. Behold, all has become new." We're new creatures. I know that. But the old man has a way of coming back to us from time to time. And we no more push out darkness and identify it and get rid of it and repent of it and deal away with it. And something else comes into our life that reminds us of how bad we need a Savior and how bad we need the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. So what do we do? I just want to encourage you to stay grounded in the foundation of who you are. You are a citizen of the kingdom. You are a child of God. Your citizenship is in heaven. Your names are written in the book of life. And no one can change that except yourself. Stay grounded in who you are. Jesus said, "Man does not live by bread alone, but every word that proceeds from the mouth of God." I love what Psalm 119 and verse 11 says. There it says, "Your word I have hidden in my heart that I might not sin against you." Stay grounded in your faith. Stay knowing who you are and whose you are. So let me close with this, and that is, a ceremony marks the beginning of something. When Jesus was baptized in the Jordan by John, it was the beginning of something. It was the beginning of his ministry as he had walked on this earth as the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Your baptism does the same thing. In fact, in Romans, the sixth chapter, beginning in verse 2 of that section of Scripture, it says, or verse 3, "Or do you not know that all of us who have been baptized into Christ Jesus have been baptized into his death? Therefore, we have been buried with him through baptism into death, so that as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, so we too might walk in newness of life. So why is it newness of life? It's newness of life because it's a fresh beginning. Acts, the second chapter in verse 38, says that when we repent and are baptized into Christ Jesus, we receive the forgiveness of sins as well as that of the Holy Spirit. Acts, the 22nd chapter and verse 16, Paul was baptized by Ananias. Ananias said to him, "What are you waiting for? Arise and be baptized and wash away your sins, calling on the name of the Lord." In Acts chapter 2, over 3,000 people were obedient to their faith. In Acts chapter 22, Paul was obedient to his faith and was baptized. It's a new beginning. You might call it a spiritual inauguration, your new beginning. And if you have not done so, why not do that this morning? All together we stand, and as we sing.